For many people, the Book of Common Prayer is primarily thought of as containing the forms of corporate worship such as Sunday Eucharist, the Easter Vigil, weddings, and funerals. However, it also contains several services that are either specifically written for private devotions or are easily transformed to do just that. Morning prayer, midday prayer, evening prayer, compline, and family devotions are all ways to help bring a liturgical element to the private times we have by ourselves and in our families. The services themselves contain written prayers called collects, which are very structured and poetic prayers, very special moments with God. It contains psalms, contains scripture, and also times for personal intercession. They all follow a general framework and allow for a person to use the lectionary, a Bible reading plan that, if it is followed, allows a person to read most of the Bible in a year or two-year period. Now, for some, there may be a little bit of an uneasiness about using a liturgy for these personal and intimate times. There is worry that it could make prayer less spontaneous and sincere and a little too mechanical. But if we allow the Holy Spirit to use these texts, these liturgies can actually give a structure that makes our time freer and more focused, allowing us not to worry about what we have forgotten, and forcing us at times to read parts of the Bible, pray prayers, and meditate on ideas that we otherwise may not have considered. And in the end, we find that the services are more like dances with God and less like rote religion. So, with that being said, how do we use the Book of Common Prayer for personal devotions? As stated before, many of these services have the same general structure. So instead of going through all of them, we are just going to focus on morning prayer. We're focusing on morning prayer for a couple of reasons. One is it's the first service in the prayer book. The other is it is actually one that this church uses. Every morning, Monday through Friday at 9 o'clock, we go through this. And so if you wanted to see this being acted out and being able to be used, just follow us along. The link will be down at the bottom of the post. Now, daily prayer, either morning, midday, evening prayer, always begins with an opening sentence. And the sentences themselves are scripture. And you will notice here, there are three scriptures that can be used. Now, further on in the prayer book, it shows different scriptures you can use at different times of the year. But in general, there are three. Now, this is good to focus on because two things can be seen. One is you will see that there are smaller print sentences that are in italics. Those things are called rubrics. And what a rubric is it helps you understand what the kind of the rules are for the service. Rubric itself comes from red, and in the old prayer books, they used to be red to help you distinguish it from the said text. The other thing is, if you notice, there are three choices. You can use these any way you want. You could say one each day. You could pick your favorite one and just go over it. What we do at church is we say Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday, Thursday, and we save the last one of the three for Friday. The reason we do this is because there are going to be other portions of this that give three choices, and the last one usually fits in very well on Friday when we think about Christ's crucifixion. So that is the very beginning of the service, this opening sentence. From there, we begin our interaction with God and with each other with a confession of sin. Now, there's two different forms. There's a very long one, and then there's one that just says, "Let us humbly confess our sins to Almighty God." Once again, there's a rubric telling you can choose either one, and either one is perfectly fine. One is used generally during, like, right before Easter when there's more of a focus on our need of Christ's forgiveness, but the other one is just, "Let us humbly confess our sins to Almighty God." From there, we begin our corporate confession. Now, this can be private, in corporate prayer. Anything that is in bold is said by the congregation or the group that's being led. In private devotions, it's just all said, of course, by the person using the form. After the confession, it is incredibly important to have the absolution. Thing is, even though you may not be a priest, Christ is the one who gives the absolution. There are three different options here. The first two are from a priest, and so it would be what the rector of the church would say, and it does have a Christ is giving you this absolution. The final one can be said by a deacon or a layperson, and it says, grant to your faithful people, merciful Lord, pardon and peace, that we may be cleansed from all our sins and serve you with a quiet mind through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Once again, it is important to know that Jesus is the one that gives this absolution. And so for people that may feel uneasy about praying a prayer of absolution, it is coming from Christ, which it comes from Christ anyways, even if the priest were saying it. From there, we go to the invitatory, right here. And what that is just the very beginning of the service. It is really beautiful when it's being said back and forth with people. It's also very edifying when you say it by yourself. Open, Lord, our lips, and our mouths shall proclaim your praise. O God, make speed to save us. O Lord, make haste to help us. Glory be to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit. As it was in the beginning, is now, and ever shall be, world without end. Praise the Lord. The Lord's name be praised. And with that, the service fully begins. And we begin with an invitatory psalm. Now, it has an antiphon. And what an antiphon is, it's a scripture, a sentence that we put at the very first of the psalm and at the very bottom. There are three here. Once again, Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday, Thursday, Friday can be used. And there are three invitatory psalms as well. Pick whichever ones you want to do. The structure that is suggested is just that you begin with one of these, you say the psalm, either the Venite, the Jubilate, on the other page is the Pascha Nostrum, and then you conclude with the same sentence. It just adds a really nice flow. Now, the next portion of this is the appointed psalm. Now, you can use your Bible if you want to, but this is where we start getting into Scripture. About halfway through the prayer book, which is nice because it's halfway through our Bible as well, are the Psalms, all 150 of them. And the reason that they're in here the way they are is, one, that it's for corporate worship. You will notice an asterisk, and then it splits this verse in half. Some churches will read the first half. A person will read it, and then people will respond with the second half. Some churches do every other verse. Private devotion, you'd be saying it all by yourself. But the reason that we have this, what's called a Psalter, is because we have translated this based on a very early translation of the Psalms that was meant to be more poetic. It's meant to be more crafted, so that as it's read in a service, it has more of a flow. Now, it is very faithful to the text. It doesn't make things up. It's just it has a different flow, and its focus, instead of just being very wooden, is instead being used very corporately. And like I said, that is in the middle of the prayer book. But where do you get these psalms? How do you know which one you're supposed to use? At the very back of the prayer book, this is this month's. It begins, of course, with January, is a lectionary. What a lectionary is, like I said at the very beginning, is a Bible study plan. And in each day, if you can see this, you have the dates over here. So, like today was June the 10th. And beside it, you have your first reading, the second reading, and then which Psalter you're going to read. Now, if you are doing morning prayer and evening prayer, which evening is on the right, you would go through the Bible in a year, most of the Bible. You would also go through the Psalms in 60 days. Now, if you're not going to do that, you can use this 1 year and this the other year, and you can go through the Bible in 2 years. It is incredibly helpful. It keeps you focused. And once again, it does make you read some portions of the Bible that you may not have wanted to read. But every 60 days, you are reading the Psalms. And it's amazing to see how important the Psalms are as you go through the Bible, because they are quoted all the time. Now, after you do the psalm and you do either the first lesson, second lesson for morning and evening prayer, whatever you do, then you go into some canticles like songs, and they are songs. You have the Te Deum Laudamus, which is one of the earliest psalms that is in the prayer book, also the Benedictus est Domine or the Benedictus. Now, those are very Latin fancy words, but it doesn't matter which one you use. Once again, it's three, so we do the Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday, Thursday, and Friday with our church, but you can just pick whichever one you like the best or just keep rotating through them. From there, we say the Apostles' Creed, our baptismal covenant. It's the smallest of the creeds. In other parts of the prayer book, you will see the Nicene Creed, which we say on Sunday, or the Athanasian Creed, which we say on Trinity Sunday. All three are used of the church and have been approved and since early Christianity. But during normal, everyday, just daily offices, the Apostles' Creed is generally the one that's used. Now, from there, that ends kind of the service of the Word, if you want to look at it in those terms. And it focuses more now on our prayers to God. We've heard from God in His Scripture, in the Psalms, and in the lectionary, and now it's our time to just pour out our heart to God. We begin with, "The Lord be with you, and with your spirit, let us pray." We go there from the Kyrie, that's a Greek word for Lord. Lord, have mercy upon us, or you can just simply say, Lord, have mercy. Once again, the rubric allows you to choose which one. Then it's the Lord's Prayer. Now, you're looking at this, and you see two columns. One is the traditional Lord's Prayer that most people know, and the other is a more modernized translation. It's the same prayer. It's just translated into modern language. Then after that, we began praying a set of prayers between the people that basically cover everything we're going to pray for anyways. We ask God to show His mercy upon us. We ask God to guide our leaders, to help our ministers. We pray for Him to save our people, to bless, give us peace, to not let the needy be forgotten, and then ultimately to create in us clean hearts. From there, we get into the collects. And as before I mentioned, they are special prayers. They are crafted and poetic. They each have different components on how they are supposed to be written. If they're not written that way, they're not really a collect. There are two different sets right here in the prayer book that you can pray. One is for the day of the week, and the other is a prayer for mission. You say one of these, and on these they actually give you the day of the week that you're going to do. On the prayer for mission, it's a set of three, so the same structure. Now, there are other collects in the prayer book, and they are all towards the end, in the mid-600s, and you'll see these numbers, like this set is for society. Our church has been praying for the human family, for social justice, and in times of social conflict or distress over the last few weeks. And you can just add in as many or as little as you would like to do. They are just lovely and really helpful for focusing your mind, especially when you may not be focused yourself. Now, the next section, you'll see these set of rubrics. There are different things you could do. You could give thanksgivings or sing a hymn or have Eucharist can be part of that. That's when this turns into a corporate thing. But it concludes after those moments with the general thanksgiving. Now, of all the prayers in the Bible, this is personally one of my favorite. We thank God for everything He has done, and then we thank Him for the redemption, the most important thing, redemption of the world by our Lord Jesus Christ. And we ask Him to not just let us do this with our lips, but in our lives, proclaiming the Word of God and rejoicing in His Spirit. The service finally concludes with the prayer of St. John Chrysostom, which acknowledges that we're all bound together. Then it ends with, "Let us bless the Lord, thanks be to God." And the final thing is an amazing versicle, an amazing concluding sentence. "The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ and love of God and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with us all evermore," or to others. And once again, just follow the pattern. Well, I hope this has been useful. And like I said, I mean, this is not the only thing there. We also have, if you go just a few pages over, daily evening prayer. And then finally, a little bit further back is Compline. And beginning right after Compline is where you get into the family prayer. Now, these are very short, very short. They might only take 10 minutes with the scriptures, maybe less. But each one, you have one for morning, midday, in the early evening, and then the close of day. Each one of these has different psalms, different scriptures, different prayers, and all of them incredibly helpful for both private and family devotions, and just a wonderful, wonderful way for us to connect with God and for us to dance in His presence in a way that connects us not just to God, but also to those, that great cloud of witnesses that has gone before us.